You think you know about relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
When he's sick, you need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good. But this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be, whoever you are. I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody. I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me. You know why?
Because you know who I was before I was me? I was you. You.
Man score 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man. Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
What's up, Square Pimper Gang? Welcome. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted. And I am truly excited today because we got a special guest. Now, I know I've said that 400 times before, but this time, I mean it!
Yeah. Nice. Finally.
How are you ready to rock and roll? You
of course,
ready? Let's get into this.
I'm doing fantastic. Just having a tough time keeping these gators down. But other than that,
it's difficult.
It's fall. Difficult. It's hard. It's Man. Hard.
Our guest today, comedy extraordinary. One of the dudes that I looked up to when I came in the comedy business. Always a good dude. Always gave people, you know, wisdom of the business and so on and so forth. The Booker for Letterman, Comedy Central, just all kinds, just everything. Give it up for my boy, Eddie Brill, y'all. Give it up for Eddie Brill. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yay, Eddie.
Nice to be here with you fellas.
It's good to see you, man. Anytime I see you, I always get a warm, we were saying that off the air. It was like one of the good ones, boy. One of the good ones.
The cockles of your heart.
Yeah, man, it's good. It's really good to see you. How you holding up with all of this nonsense going on?
I'm all right. You know, I mean, it's not. There's a lot of anxiety involved. You know, I at the beginning, I just ate my way through the East Village and all. But other than, you know, I've decided, you know, the pity party's over a few months ago, and I've been writing all the time and being creative. I got to stand up for the first time in a legitimate scenario. For my birthday, it just happened to fall on my birthday. It was the first time I had done stand-up in 149 days.
Wow.
And it's not that I counted them. It's just I asked Siri. It was easy.
Yeah.
How many days between March 14th and October 16th?
Yeah.
149.
What'd you do?
There's a comedy club called the Alameda Comedy Club in Alameda, California, which is next door to Oakland.
Okay.
And the guy, Patrick, and his wife, Lori, they're just amazing people. And I helped them to design their club, you know. And so their club is gorgeous. And it's made for comedy. It's made for comics. And they're really good people. But they can't do it indoors. So they have what they created before this all went down is they created a backyard kind of idea where the people for the next show can hang out,
sit around, order some food. So they swapped it out. Yeah.
So they did the comedy there, and they were allowed to put 40 people in there. And it was very intimate, despite the fact that people had to be spaced out.
Yeah.
And it was really – the first show was interesting because, I've been doing this for 36 years. And, all of a sudden, I can feel my brain working. But the second show, it was like I had never left. And it was, there was a 10 p.m. curfew because we're outdoors. I could have gone till all night. I was
really feeling so good.
Of all the things I've done in my life, and I've done a lot and had so many dreams come true, dreams I never dreamed I would ever have. But I still love stand-up as much, even more. That's the number one thing for me. So to be able to do it again, that was pretty special.
Yeah. I just started getting back up. Just like recently, I've done maybe four shows Harry, maybe four or five.
Yeah, four or five.
These roof things or these drive-in
roofs, things? Roofs. I've done half drive-in, half social distance. Yeah, I've done drive-in. I couldn't do the Zoom thing. I just was like, it's not even stand-up.
It's not for us.
Dante, sorry. Can you adjust your mic up a little bit? I think you, just a little bit. Sorry about that.
Yeah, no, you're right. The Zoom things, I did one and it was like, that's enough.
Yeah.
You know, one word and it was enough.
Yeah, that just didn't seem like the same level. I will say that it does all this going through the pandemic thing. It makes me feel like something I learned in the last couple of years of appreciating stuff. So now we appreciate doing live comedy a little more, like something that got taken away for a little bit. Yeah. And so it's important to not forget, like, to be in the moment and go, oh, this is pretty cool. You know, this is
Have you been doing shows as well, Harry?
I've been doing a couple here and there. I tried to avoid the Zoom shows. I knew I wasn't going to like it right up front. Yeah. I've done a couple outdoor that haven't been bad, but also I think my standards have kind of lessened, so I'm okay now. At first, it was like to do the outdoor parking show, the parking lot shows. If a car honks, celebrate, I'm going to lose my shit. I can't. Yeah. I didn't sign up to be honked at by a car. Like, it's the gathering of the juggalos or whatever. That's,
Very Terjanian, hunky.
Right.
It's an interesting thing when you start to understand the energy of comedy. So for me, Eddie, you've seen me when I first started. I mean,
Yeah, you had so much energy that you knew that, once you connected to material,
right.
you were going to take it to
thank
the next
you,
level.
Thank you, man. Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that.
It was evident from the beginning.
I appreciate that. And then I kind of, how everybody kind of goes into their own, it's like every comic has there's their own martial arts, and there are kind of people that have invented that, taekwondo, karate, one of our friends is like Todd Berry was the first guy to do that low energy kind of low energy, just kind of, rhythmic,
smart material.
Yeah.
Rhythm,
yeah.
Like you said, yeah.
And then, people don't talk about this, but like Greg Rogel, was right. At one time, I remember watching Greg and he and still is, but so lean, so just every word is important, and it's taken me a little more time because I've kind of evolved to like this kind of organic, kind of conversational thing. I mean, because I kind of I hung out with Patrice all the time, and those influences. It's funny, my all time stylistic flavors is Patrice. Marin, Patrice Marin and Colin.
Oh boy, I thought Gallagher was gonna sneak in there.
Gallagher's actually a good.
He actually good comic.
He's pretty
back
good.
In the
He's
day.
A good guy.
But those kind of, and then how it becomes, and because you watch guys who kind of melded into something, it became something else with time. Like as a what up, killer.
Yeah.
Who it is? Andre's
what
joining
up, killer?
Us. Oh,
Andre,
finally a nice background. Look at this. Yeah,
I like it.
I like the light. I've never seen your other background, but that's
you got a background.
We have actual background.
You know what I mean, yeah. Hold on. I gotta move it. Wait a minute.
There you go.
Don't see what's behind the curtain.
Oh, it fell. Too much going on at one time. How we doing, fellas?
What's going on, baby?
Doing good.
You look like Moment Chance.
Right? I'm doing a lot of shit. Too much going on.
It's funny. That's the second Moment Chance reference this week. I guess it's funny how that works out.
Dre, you know what Moment Chance is?
No.
Used to be a thing like Blue Man Group, but they were like Black Man Group. They were in all black, and they would have.
Wait,
like,
are you saying the Blue Man also stole their music from the Black Man?
Yeah, of course.
Man?
They steal everything from
the Black Man. Come on
now. Ain't that a shame?
Woman's chance matters.
Niggas can't have nothing, not even color.
Yeah.
But they would have things on it, like big post-its, like on their head, and that would be eyeballs, and they would look this way, and it was kind of like Blue Man Group.
It doesn't sound good the way he's describing it.
But it was good.
It was actually pretty good.
It was pretty good.
It was also the 80s.
Post-its
so
on your head, that's the last thing. Yeah, right. I'm going to do the post-its guy.
It was before PlayStations, so it was entertaining. Yeah, yeah. It was very entertaining.
Dre, so we were talking about difference, just to fill you in, we were talking about how different comics take up from other comics and then it evolves into something else. It's taken me a little longer to knock the rust off because for me, it's not just digging into my technique. It's kind of, okay, where am I at now?
But you know what's interesting, Dante, is like in life, I started to do that years, later than I wanted to. But I do take like different, just life, not comedy. You go, oh, from that guy, from my dad, I'll take that part of it, like being caring. But I won't take my dad's stress levels. His handling stress, that I'll learn from somebody else. But like... Yeah. Respect thing.
Learn that from me.
From you.
Right.
Push-ups and weed.
I've only known you for 20 seconds, and I've got the stress of putting up the background and, you know, worrying about how Moomin Chance has taken over the color.
Dre really reminds me of me as I don't know, because I was just so much. Like, it was just a lot. Like, it was just always, and not like trying to be a lot, but just, see, look at this. Look at this.
A bag of fun. Yeah.
A bag of fun.
Yeah.
Oh, a volcano.
I remember being in the basement of the comic strip, and there was a guy who lived there. And had
Seamus?
Yeah, Seamus. He had a
bag. Well, Eddie was, Eddie was trying not to name names, Dante. Eddie was trying to keep it on the DL.
Is that a guy who
I don't keep it on the DL. Look,
that's how long Seamus has been around. Seamus has been around before me.
He's been around before bags. You know, you had to just chuck it out of his hand back then.
Seamus.
You know, it's funny. One thing I heard a couple of years ago that really helped change, because I keep changing and evolving as a human, as a comedian, like all of us. Sure. There was Michelangelo makes the Statue of David. It's this, you know, incredible piece of art. And they asked him, how did you make this statue out of this chunk of marble? And he said, I just chipped away at the pieces that weren't him. And so I was like, all right, that means a lot to me. So,
yeah, the art is in it. It's in there already. You just
I'm influenced by, you know, George Carlin and Richard Pryor and, you know, and then the, you know, the sillier Jonathan Winters, Lily Tomlin kind of thing. Those are my early influences. And then later on, Damon Wayans and, you know, I can go on and on, Chris Rock. And of course, my favorite comic of all time, I would say now, is Chappelle. Because, you know why? Because Chappelle came out and he told the truth and he told his truth and he didn't know any better. And he just kept telling his truth. And as he evolved as a human, he just kept telling his truth.
Yeah.
And that's what I've learned. But it has to come from within. I saw a tape of mine from 1986. And I'm singing and I'm dancing and I'm in good shape and I have a lot of hair and I'm doing all this. And I see where I've come from that. But also at the same time, when I go back now, I want to bring some of that energy and dancing inside my body, you know, on stage.
Some joy.
What's that?
Scoop some joy from your past. Yeah, right. I get it.
It's funny. A bag of fun for that.
It's funny how when you're young, you have all that energy, and sometimes it could go one way or the other. Like, I'm always a fan of the angry comic, the guy who decides a character
who has
be the
to
angry
come
comic,
and be
but,
angry every day,
right,
every,
but
no
doesn't
matter
have
what,
anything like
since his birthday.
These napkins
birthday,
at the Starbucks.
He just got laid.
Yeah.
Right.
He's got to muster up all this anger to do his act. You're like, I can't do that. What's interesting about that is learning to be present. And then, you know, so the show is basically about relationships. And what I find is being in that place where you're comfortable, where you really are comfortable, is the thing that makes you more attractive to people.
And not trying to please people is another thing I learned. And you know, when people say to me, well, you know, Chappelle offended these people, I go, well, he's not here to please them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's not his job. And I always thought I wanted to please everybody. I didn't want to take chances. I wanted to please people. And then I realized, well, you know, if the result, or, you know, is that you please them, that's great. But your job is not to please them. Your job is to tell your truth. And again, that's what I've learned so much from watching Chappelle, you know, even though he's younger than me.
But what's interesting even about that is that when you talk about the older comics, a lot of the older comics, that was about being industry ready. And yeah. with now, even with podcasting, it's like people, you are who you are. Like that's why the fans for your podcast and whatever is so rabid, because they get to see all of you, you know, every aspect of you. So they know you, even though you don't know them personally, they know you because you're, I mean, how many episodes we got?
This would be 445 episodes. Right,
so we've been doing this like 8 years. And so It's sort of like when the reality TV, the cameras sink into the background and you don't see them anymore. And you just start acting natural again. But it's a natural, but it's interesting how the medium has become so much wider, which gives it much more of an allowance to be honest.
And it was that way before everyone thought they had to create this something that they weren't. And
Was it that way in early comedy?
I would say, you know, Bob Newhart just came out on stage and just his first album was like the first time he did that material at a club. And it was brilliant because he was just being his self, you know.
Right.
I mean, if you go back to like a Mom's Mabley, you know, I saw her documentary again recently.
Yeah.
She, you know, was just herself. And so in that time, you know, despite whatever society was, the ills of society or the uptightness that still carries on today, people teach us lessons to just, you know, again, get to your truth. Don't try to package it. Like, you know, I'll give you, if you do a television set for, say, Letterman back in the day or whatever show you would do it, it was like you had an album and of your stuff and you wanted to play a cut off your album. So that's what you create, a 4.5-5 minute set to show the audience like that you're marketable. But, you know, you don't have to do that anymore because you have the internet and you have cable television and you.
But if you want to go mainstream, it's still that way. It's still okay. Yeah. This is a slice of what I do. Andre just did Fallon, so he's like, we're really happy about him doing.
Yeah, it was a whole shaving down of me. Like I felt handcuffed the whole time. It was
which is no good.
Not handcuffed and not to curse on.
Yeah, which I still did.
Well, you know, look, Richard Pryor did the Tom Jones show, and he was irreverent and brilliant, and it was international television. He didn't curse once, but he really was edgy and smart. So you can get away, you know, like...
Yeah, but it's even that's not the thing. I mean, that's why so many, what you call it, what's the dude, Joe Rogan just sold his podcast for $100 million. Right. And Joe Rogan does and says whatever. I think what happened with the industry, and the industry was always, and you've been in the industry for a long time, people that were deciding these are the boxes that you need to be in.
Yeah, it has nothing to do even with cursing. Like the jokes that I did on there, they cut out parts that were possibly going to be offensive. There was parts of it that mentioned police and stuff like that, and it wasn't me. Like, it wasn't nothing crazy. It wasn't NWA. Right. Fuck the police style. It was just, this is the situation with the cops. When we see them, it's a little timid.
That was the thing That was the thing, Dre, where you did about going to the real
going through the forest. And
It wasn't even that. It's like, it's the police. It wasn't even like,
it was all of that shit.
Yeah, well, you're playing with, you know, insecurity and paranoia. So, you know, the one thing about the Letterman show is, you know, we would never punch down because Letterman.
Well, let me say this first. I want the fans to understand that Eddie booked the comics on Letterman. For how many years?
We work on a set. We wouldn't cut out material unless it was punching down, you know, because Letterman wasn't that kind of a guy, and that's not what he wanted on his show. But a comedian, you know, guys like Jim Norton and you know, Nick DiPaolo, you know, who are some of the edgiest comics in the world, got to do their material on the show as long as it wasn't, you know, as long as it was smart and clever, and you never took a piece of their bit out so that they couldn't do it, because then why do it? You know?
It's interesting, like in the context of relationships, that same, it's something like when you get on stage, there's always a metaphor. When you get on stage, if you're needy, you give the power up to the audience, and then they decide whether they want to withhold or not. Whereas
the subtle difference is, if I say to you, you know, why does this happen? If I tell you that, I'm giving up my power. But if I say, I've often wondered why this happened.
It's a different, yeah.
And all that little adjustment, little different. You got the power.
Here's a crazy thing. I would tell guys, even when a guy would like, so say a guy approaches a girl for a date or whatever, and he says, you know, I'd like to take you out or whatever. And then she's not.
She's wishy-washy, like not sure.
Yeah, like just not really being decisive about it. And then
take back that offer immediately. Go, right, you know what? Never mind.
You take it back. You go, listen, if you're not interested in this, or like even better, like you're trying to hook up with somebody and you text them, whatever, and you can't link up, and then they're like, and they're not really in it, you got to go, I'm not. I go, listen, I don't, you know, guys would always say, listen, I don't want to waste your time and I don't want to waste my time. We always prerequisite that. I don't want to waste your time because it softens the blow that you're putting your particular happiness first.
Right.
So I would tell guys, don't say, I don't want to waste your time. Because if you're being a bitch and you don't want to, and you're making it difficult, I don't care. Honestly, the authenticity is, I don't care about your time. I'm only saying, I don't want to waste your time as a way to not seem as though I'm selfish enough. Or I'm selfish.
Like you said, soften the blow. It's exactly.
But the thing is, the only thing people respect is when you don't soften the blow. They respect.
This is unfortunate, ain't it?
Yeah.
I'll be trying to be nice to motherfuckers. I don't want to say nothing. I don't want to be mean. But they push it, yo.
Yeah, no, but on comedy, Dre, you're pretty. You're honest in every. You know, I actually think you're honest even when it comes to those situations.
Yeah, I'm gonna say it.
Yeah.
But it's like reluctant. Like I wish I didn't have to tell you off right now. Like I wanted this to be nice and chill.
But that's what happens with age. You know, the older you get, all of a sudden you go, I'm not putting up with that bullshit anymore.
Yeah.
It comes with age and also just experience and the number of wins you get because.
And a vat of awful bitches. Yeah,
as Keith Robinson.
Nice. Is that the name of the podcast?
That you go through that. But like, yeah, I'll do that. I would do that if a girl would be like, oh, I don't want to give you my phone number, but I'll give you my Instagram, and I'd be like, nah, thank you.
Look, listen,
Instagram.
Yeah,
like I
don't want to give you my phone number, but I'm going to give you half a gram. Yeah. Oh, okay. I'll take. All right.
Yeah, that's different.
Check my MySpace. Check my MySpace.
Nah, son. The only way I'm going to accept a gram from a bitch is if it's weed. That's the only way I'll take a gram. Otherwise, keep it.
And I'm not taking nothing less than 3 grams.
No telegram, no honeygram crackers, none of that.
But it's interesting just finding that place where you settle in. You settle in with yourself, you know, with who you are. So it was funny because I started comedy late, and so I was already a formed human being, you know, and so I wasn't trying to figure out who I was. I was just trying to figure out how to be myself on stage. But the same, you know, it's like I always say, you know, true wisdom is the underlying concept, is the understanding of the underlying concept that may seem like it's irrelevant, but it's really not. So you boil it down to the root and you understand the concept, and then you can repeat, you can reapply that concept over and over in your life throughout the rest. And that's what wisdom is being able to see the connections. And
like Harry said at the beginning about his father, you know, the same exact thing, you know, you take the best of what you can, but be the most authentic self you can be. And that's really the key, because like I had said to you earlier in this thing as well, it's like you had so much energy, but you didn't connect to what you were talking about.
Yeah,
once you connect to what you're talking about, the audience senses it and you bring them in.
They sense that you're not. Now, sometimes it's bringing them in. Sometimes people snatch them in. Sometimes people go, I don't really give a fuck about what you, this is what I'm saying. And all of those things, because they're authentic, becomes attractive.
Yes,
you know,
and there are no rules. You know, if they said, you know, you have to have set up punch or these kind of things, or you know, you wouldn't have, you know, Andy Kaufman.
Yeah,
You wouldn't have Maria Bamford, you know, if you had to have this kind of thing. So there's no rules, you know.
Right, right.
If you're your most authentic self, that's
the thing with that no rules thing. It is very true, but I found in spaces they don't fully accept it. Like, when it comes to, even when it comes to race, like, there's a certain archetype of a black man that is accepted. The Star Wars dude that don't get no pussy. I'm a little scared of everybody.
Oh, yeah.
But, like, when there's a, it's rough. Like, I've found
I'm more of a Star Trek guy that gets no pussy. What's your character? What are you suggesting?
I like Star Trek, but I still get some fuzzy. That's it. I ain't got no beef for nobody.
You're going places where no man has ever gone before.
That's true.
That's what she said.
But I know what you're saying, Andre. This is, you know, people don't want certain things, but if you come with who you are, you know, and
you don't give them an option.
Yeah, like, you don't give them an option.
This is what I'm selling. What you got? This is what I'm selling.
Not even this is what I'm selling. This what you buying. You buying this shit.
Yeah. Right.
Give me your money.
Yeah.
Run them pockets.
Yeah, it's an interest. So I talk to a lot of dudes that are having difficulties, especially with the whole, you know, how things have been turned on its head, things that are unacceptable and that used to be acceptable and not acceptable. But, you know, and I've always gotten, well, how does this affect you? Because I've always kind of, you know, ran around like a maniac and chased women and chased skirts and they chase me and whatever, but I never was in a situation where I wanted to fuck somebody who didn't want to fuck me.
Right.
Yeah. Like, they just, I'm not begging you. Yeah. I'm not begging you. I'm not trying to sell it to you. Who I am sells it. You see the respect that people treat me. There's a reason why that happens.
And some people who like it and some people who don't. And that you can't try to please everybody. And that's what I try to do for so long in my early comedy is, you know, trying to please, you know.
But that's
and that's what I would say. I said I would never kiss someone who didn't want to kiss me back.
Right, right, right.
Bottom line.
If you don't want to be here, you don't have to be here. You can leave. Just because you're too stupid to understand how valuable I am doesn't diminish my value.
But then also you have to remember ego. You know, we all have an ego, and sometimes it gets in our way. And I found out once you show your vulnerability, which is more of a strength than ego, you know, as young boys, we're taught macho, macho, macho. And it turns out that's just a game. That's just an insecurity game where, you know, it's more about being vulnerable. And the more vulnerable and honest you are, I think that makes you more of a stronger human and more attractive to other people because I can act cool, or maybe I can act cool, but I, you know, I'm a nerd, you know, that's who I am. I'm a comic. I'm someone who looks at, you know, life and words and plays with them in a very nerd way. And if that's attracts somebody, that's the person I want to be with.
Right.
But that's, I've noticed from Eddie, Eddie's always been a sweetheart of a guy, like even the younger comics and people he didn't know, people he didn't have to be nice to. But there is a certain swagger that you have because you aren't worried about where the next gig is. Like, you know what you do, and you get that after you have done it for so many years that you know what you're doing.
Right. But now I've gotten to a point where, you know, I spend a lot of my career helping other comics, which I love, which I do because I was helped by, you know, I can name drop the shit out of some of the greatest comics who really went out of their way to help me. But now I'm 62. And people are like, well, you know, we're not looking for a 62-year-old man, unless you're like, say, Lewis Black or somebody, just as one example.
It's already established.
Already established and famous. Yeah. So it's a situation where I have to go back out there and hustle. But at the same time as I'm hustling, when I go on stage, they might not remember my name, but they'll never forget me because I go out there and I'm being the most Eddie Brill I could be.
Are you dating now, Eddie?
I haven't since the COVID thing.
Okay.
I had met someone right before it who lived in Texas, and that was, it was a really good scenario, but you know, because of it there had, and I wrote one of my earliest jokes was, and I hate to do jokes, but I like this one. I said, you know, I hadn't pleased myself or pleasured myself in like 3 days and was like, was it something I said? You know, because I was the only person involved. Yeah. You know, I, that's where I'm at. That's,
yeah.
I'm sort of alone. And there's not a lot of people who, well, you know, I'm going to fly to New York and go hang out with you in this COVID world and where, you know.
No, I get it. I mean, but in general, like you get, a lot of times I'll get calls from older guys, not even 62, and they kind of feel like, oh, they diminish their value because of their age. That becomes, and what they don't understand is like me as a 50-year-old guy, if I'm dealing with some young girl, I always say this, I got a guy. I mean, like, whatever you need, I can either do it, oh, I know a guy that could do it. If you need rims, I can get you rims.
You need a rim job? I got that.
You need implants? I got a guy for implants. And so the difference is
you got a booty implant guy.
You got a car that runs on vegetable oil. I know the dude at the Popeye's Chicken can give you the vegetable oil, and that only comes
through relationships and doing it over and over and over again.
Right. Experience in life.
I got a task rabbit.
Right.
Yeah, but we didn't have a task rabbit before. Right. Y'all fucking up my hustle.
I came with a real rabbit. Get that.
You had to do the work. You know, it's interesting how technology changed. He just said, I got a task rabbit, and I'm like, motherfucker, he sure do. It's my main shit. I got a guy that's gonna hook you up.
That's different.
Task rabbit, have to pay the price. My man. Tell him Dante sent you. I'm gonna hit him on the hammer. Coming over, boom, 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 boom,
boom. Even if you don't have a guy, you have knowledge like, oh, I know how.
I could get a guy. I know a guy who's got a guy.
You're right. Mm-hmm. I know how we could do that, or I know how we could fix that, or I've been there. Oh, I know if you want to go dancing, I know how to do that, or where to go. Just different life experience that's pretty valuable.
All kind of dances, Harry? I can ask you for any type of dance?
What kind of dance?
I want to see Harry do the light feet. The niggas that be on the train, Showtime.
They got plenty of room.
Flipping your hat around and shit, nigga.
Oh yeah, you know, jump on top and grab the ceiling fan and spin around.
Do that shit, boy.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do the Coney Island bone breaking. Oh, I'm gonna just do it like this: beep, 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 beep. It's crazy. It's a weird thing though. You know, people. People don't understand what their value is, and because when they don't understand what their value, a lot of times they're trying to move the needle in their career and their relationship and whatever. And when you don't understand your value, it's almost like you feel like you're shoplifting.
Well, you know, like, we're bombarded with, you know, advertising, religion, and politics, and our parents who are trying to create this comfort zone for themselves, you know, understandably. So we're bombarded that we're pieces.
Wait, say that again. Tell me what you mean by that, trying to create this comfort zone.
Yeah, you know, you're a parent. Like, I have a kid who's a comic. He's 33. I want him to have a great life. I'm going to try to make it easy for him. At the same time, let him be his own person. So, you know, it's that juggling, that kind of thing. So I'm never going to be dishonest with him. But you will have parents. You know, my parents wanted the best for me. And my mom was the biggest supporter of my comedy. My dad wasn't. Eventually, he became that way. So just of that part of the conversation is that they'll tell you, like, when I was a kid, I watched the Beatles and I wanted to grow my hair long. And my dad's like, those are wigs, because he didn't want me to grow my hair. He's protecting me from getting shit at school. But, you know, looking back, I wouldn't have cared what people had thought about that. But what I was saying more about, like, advertising, they need you to buy their product. So they got to get you either addicted to it or say that you're a piece of shit. And the only way that you'll get out of being a piece of shit is by using their product.
Right.
Yeah, that's the whole idea.
And they're very good at it.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. It's like, you know, I have silver hair and there's Just for Men. And it's for insecure guys who want to meet shallow women. But that's really what it is. But they don't say that. They say, no one's going to fuck you if you don't use Clearasil. You know, no one's going to fuck you if you have gray hair. And then you're like, I want sex. So I'm going to put this shit in my head.
Right.
So we're victims of it because they're so good at it.
And it bombards you. It's such a consistent
like
bombardment.
Yeah. Like, you know, how did a guy like Hitler become a big star or Mussolini become a big star? It's because they use the techniques that advertising, you know, over and over, saying the same thing over and over again until it becomes the truth, you know. And then we see that today in politics or in advertising or whatever. So, you know, one of the things to do is to deconstruct that whole thing. As a comic, we get to deconstruct it. And then we could see, and we're still affected. I mean, when I was a kid, I would get sugar frosted flakes because of Tony the Tiger. You know, I mean, that's what I did. And I put sugar on my sugar frosted flakes, you know, because I wanted that spoonful of diabetes on the bottom. But even as I was older, you know, I'm older. It's like, they're great. And they're really not great. But I, you know, here I am. I know they're great because some tiger told me it was great. But that's the thinking behind what as a comic, we get the chance to deconstruct it and say, hey, look, this, you know, look behind the curtain. You know, there's some guy there whose job it is to get you to do something. You know, look inside yourself, you know, and that's not the message on television. That's not the message on the radio. That's why, again, podcasts work so well, because if you're willing to tell the truth, your truth, and not be ashamed of it.
Yeah. People want to hear it. They want to hear your truth. It's also an interesting thing when you know, when we're trying to find that like you said, that balance of safety and still pushing. But, you know, and one of the things that I always say about, like, my dad and my mom, my dad was born 1920. So a lot of them, like, at that, they were just trying to survive. They weren't trying to flourish. You weren't trying to act. They weren't trying to actualize their happiness. They were just trying to live, eat, and survive until at some point when they got to a level. And so we had the luxury of going, oh, I'm gonna just explore different things. I want to try stand up comedy and acting and whatever, because we started actualizing fulfillment, self fulfillment. And so people are so unfulfilled, and they're such, and really not, I find people are really not smart. Like, like basic fundamentals, like something, so I always say this, it would be really interesting if somebody would teach a logic class, like a practical, critical thinking, because.
But that goes against what, you know, the people in charge will not be successful if we're educated. That's why Carlin was so popular, because he would break it down and say, look, you know, they're fooling you. They're not on your team. You know, Chappelle recently said to somebody at a party, and he was talking about it, I think, when he was interviewed by Letterman, which is one of the greatest interviews.
Yeah, that was good. In a long time. Oh, that's the new one that came out. Just came out, right?
Yeah, that was during the debates, and I watched people telling the truth instead of people lying.
Yeah.
But he said, you know, to you people in the audience, you know, you're saying that Trump helps me, you know, the poor people, and Chappelle says, no, he's helping me, the rich people. But, you know, there's so much lying, and there's so much, you know, they're playing charades with the truth. Not that I want to get into who's the best politician, you know.
Yeah, we know Trump sucks a dick, so that's fine.
We used to book him on Letterman because he was a clown and great television.
But it's interesting how how people will contort. They'll contort their own morality to fit into that, to attach that, because they see value in him. They see themselves, they see themselves in him.
Right. Television is such a powerful medium. They think he's really a successful businessman who was the apprentice guy.
Yeah.
You know, like, people see the bachelorette and they think that's how relationships work.
I'll tell you, I did a couple of episodes. I did like 8 episodes of Blacklist. And in the scene, the writing is, I got a snitch on the main character. And I, when it came out, I went, came through the hood, and it was like, yo, you snitching? Yo, you, I'm like, I didn't write. And here's how ghetto I was. I didn't even want to say, I didn't want to say the line. I was talking to the, I feel like he should, like, do it like this. So the line would be like, I'm going to tell everything. And I'd be like, look, I didn't see nothing. They're like, cut. That's not what the line
is. Right, right.
because I was so programmed that you don't that you
well, you
shouldn't
halted production because you needed a lawyer. You're like, I need my attorney.
And you probably knew my brother-in-law because he was the director of photography for that show.
Oh yeah, yeah. And then the other thing is when my character snitched and then he ends up not snitching in front of all the bigwigs, so I was good, so I'm still good in the hood. But I mean, the point is the people perceive that as if this was real. It's like this becomes so real for them, you know?
It's very dirty business. There was a Bravo show that myself and some more and somebody else, I forgot, Joy Behar, we were the judges. Mm. And Artie Fuqua was there with his girlfriend and can't think of the other comedian's name, and the wives were going to change jobs with the comedians, and and so they were going to be comedians, the wives, or the girlfriend of Artie, and Matarise was the
Okay.
So Matarise's wife was brilliant. She was a lawyer. She was a very funny, very sharp, and Artie.
She's a psychiatrist, isn't she, though?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, she's a psychiatrist,
a lawyer. She was just really sharp.
Yeah.
And Artie Fuqua's girlfriend was a fantastic person, but she wasn't a good comic. So we were being honest with her and everything, and they stopped the camera. And they said, look, you know, you're going to give it away because you got to say good things about Artie Fuqua's girlfriend. I'm sorry, I don't remember her name. You know, or
he don't either. He don't remember her name either.
But I did, you know, but on Joe Matarise's wife, I think her name was Stephanie, you have to say bad things to her. And all three of the judges were like, we don't think bad things about her. Yeah. They go, you got to make it up so that it looks like it's close. Like they're going to, you don't know who's going to win. So it ended up Stephanie won. She was deserving of it. The other person wasn't. But we got letters, all three of us judges, galore from angry, angry people. You voted for the wrong person because they only saw the edit that they did. Yeah. In this show, and it was so dirty to have to lie and to have to make up this thing to try to, you know. And that's when I vowed never to do that kind of television.
You know, I it's interesting you say that because being doing that even for television, it there's a dirty feeling. Like once you start to center yourself in truth, then it starts, you get accustomed to the cleanness of truth, that the minute you get smudged with a little bit of nonsense or lies or whatever, it just makes it less capable of you. Like you can't even swallow it after a while. So I even got to the point where, like, I used to watch Maury Povich, and I know it's scripted and stuff. It was like my guilty pleasure, but I stopped watching it because I just didn't want to support the misinformation. It's like, this is why we are where we are right now. This is why I get dudes calling me like, I can't get a girl, I'm 40 years old and I'm still a virgin and I'm, you know, crazy shit, because there's a move, because truth is at a fundamental level, truth is the baseline. If that's the baseline, then everything works, has a foundation to come from. If you're starting at misinformation and deception, and, you know, like something I say all the time is like, I don't do awkward. I'm not doing awkward.
What you mean? You don't do awkward.
If I'm engaging with you and it's uncomfortable and it's unpleasant, yo, I'll see you. I'm out. Because either you're crazy and you're unaware because you're not paying attention, or you don't give a fuck.
Right.
And you don't respect me. Both situations make me not want to fuck with you at all, because it's like, why are we doing this? It's like you get a chance to engage with good people and exchange ideas and be creative. Why would you want anything else other than, unless you're lacking yourself?
You ever think about how you, like, your relationship to people, their perception shit, like the way they look at you, they already start off different. Before you said anything,
happened, I'm not sure what you mean by, in which direction does it look different?
Like,
do it look different to you or do it look different to them?
To them. You're you. You are who you are.
Okay, say it again, because I'm I didn't catch it.
Like, you are who you are. You're yourself.
No, no. Say the first part. I'm gonna hear the first part. You said,
nigga, I don't remember.
I just had a bag of fun.
Listen, my brain doing what it's doing. You feel me?
All right, good. Come on with it. Come on.
So use you, and then the people, like, their perception of you is what indicates how they'll treat you or react to anything you say. Where, for example, like, if somebody, there's been times where I'm in a crowded club and somebody would bump into me and they would apologize to the point I was now offended.
Oh, yeah.
I know what that apology truly come from. I don't see you as a fully developed rational being with a brain that can understand the circumstances that will cause you to bump into me in this situation, which makes it believable that you are okay. You're absolved of all issue, but they don't see it that way. They see me as a 6'2", 200 and something pound bully.
They look at me like a gun. Like you're a savage. Like you have no self-control.
And like, holy fuck. I don't know.
And there's no use for those kind of people who are, and in some situations you can't blame them because of their training through life and their constant bombardment. You know, the foundation for comedy is the truth. It's always been the foundation. I mean, there are situations where it comes out of not the truth, but most of it comes with the foundation of the truth, and the same thing in life. Like, you were asking me earlier if I'm dating anyone, but I'm not physically involved with anyone right now. Mm-hmm. But, you know, one of the great parts of sex is the mental part of sex. So the relationships I do have with people who I talk to and interact with, and, you know, and that's as sexy and as powerful and honest and as, you know, fulfilling.
That's the real foreplay.
Yeah.
That mind fuck is serious shit. Yeah. And when you're vibing and it becomes like this dance I took salsa for a bunch of years. And when
I ate
first
salsa just earlier with some chips.
Oh yeah.
So how ironic.
I was learning this, and then once I, like, the second year, it became kind of like comedy, very fluid, right? But like, when I would dance with a girl who follows well, it was just easy and fun. And then I would have I would dance with somebody else who wouldn't follow, and she'd be wanting to do it, and I felt like I was dragging her around the dance floor the whole time. And so when you say that intellectual banter, that intellectual dance is what's attractive. And so even on a base level, when you're first talking to that is going on, and guys don't understand. A lot of time they're not paying attention that is actually what's going on.
And the same in comedy. It's that symphony that you have with the audience, and that you have with, you know, with the truth and with the power and with the vulnerability and the strength that comes with that. It's very sexy.
You know what's interesting, Dre? What you said about somebody, sorry, and you, I know exactly what you're saying, because, you know, people treat me
you're
that
a big
way.
Big black nigga, that's why, you know what
and
I'm
they,
saying.
And they go, and it's like everybody else will tell you that you're nuts. Yo, they don't mean it that way.
When
they
say excuse me, they don't hear excuse me. They hear, like, they flip the fuck out. It's so crazy. Much more. Like, I have to constantly measure or monitor
this,
my
this is why a lot of times.
And you and the, peasants, the, and you're cheating yourself by doing that.
Yeah, you know? I don't do that anymore. I'm fine with people being pussy around me because they can't stand it. That's okay. If you wasn't built like me, that's not your fault.
Yeah.
I allow you to be
around
me.
And, you know, some people, they don't have bad intentions. They just were trained poorly. There's material that works in Europe for me. Halfway through the sentence, I'll get a laugh, where in America, they won't, because Americans were not educated the same way they were in Europe. I can't blame the audience. I can't blame someone because they didn't have parents that took care of them, or friends that were influential, or they weren't, you know, like, beat up by their older brother or sister, but we all do that.
I think it's a human instinct to a certain degree. We just go by patterns, but it will work against you every once in a while. Like, every once in a while, I'll see a guy who's wearing a suit at an event or something, and they're working, and they're dressed really immaculately, and you kind of think they know what they're doing.
And then halfway through,
you're like, oh, this person's a fucking idiot.
Yeah. Let's stop this right? And we're going to keep going. Is it okay?
Yeah, why not? Let's do Eddie, would you join us for some Patreon for the...
Just behind the paywall. We're going to put this... what do you want me to close it out?
Yeah, you could close it out just to let everybody know. We're going to do a little bit... we'll do a bonus show with Eddie over at patreon.com/manschool202. And shout out and thank you to all the patrons who contributed and... who've been enjoying the bonus episodes and a couple of the special that we put out and stuff. So, you know, it's much appreciated. We love that you guys have our back.
And then spread the word, please. Support us so we can keep doing this. Manschool 202 is created by Dante Nero, hosted by Dante Nero, with Harry Terjanian and Andre D. Thompson, produced by Harry Terjanian. Executive producers, Matt Kleinschmidt, Harry Terjanian, and Dante Nero.